Well, good morning, Harvest. It's good to be with you all. I want to rush and say thanks to God, my Lord and Savior, and the head of this house, as well as all of those that call him Savior and Lord. And secondly, I want to say thank you to the pastors, elders, campus pastors, Pastor Jeff, as well as Pastor Carl, friends of mine that I've gotten to know. And I want to thank them because I think in this pandemic, as well as just pastoring and running of a church, sometimes what we do can go unnoticed a bit. And sometimes we come to church and we sit down, and unless it's hot like this, and we just get used to being in church. We get used to being in our groups, our small groups, and sometimes the thought of what it takes to put on service or preach or pastor or reach out to youth, sometimes it's just something that we do as a formality. And I just want to let y'all in on it. Pastoring is hard, y'all. Pastoring and preaching, and it's tough, especially going through a pandemic. So what I would love to do, if you guys could do this for just a moment, this may not be something you do at Harvest, but I would love for you all, if you would, just put your hands together and just say thank you to your pastors and elders and staff and people at this church that have just worked hard. Yes, they've done a great job. You guys have continually come this far through this pandemic. God is up to something here at Harvest Bible Chapel. As he said, I'm the pastor of Renewal Church of Chicago. It's a vibrant, multi-ethnic church, gospel-centered church in the city of Chicago. We're just now celebrating 8 years this year. I planted it with my wife some years ago, and when we moved up here from Memphis, Tennessee, and God has continued to blow our minds with what he's doing in the city of Chicago. If you're ever in the city, make sure to come visit us. I promise you, you'll have a good experience, and you'll enjoy the service, but make sure to come check us out, if not online. But also, I run the Chicago Partnership, as he mentioned earlier. The Chicago Partnership, if you didn't catch the video back in February where I did with Pastor Jeff, it's a network or partnership of churches that come together, and we partner together, and we pool our resources to where we can plant churches and pastor churches, send out pastors and church plants throughout the city of Chicago. Our vision is to make Jesus visible in every neighborhood in the city of Chicago. We want to see the city better because of churches being planted, churches being revitalized, and people doing the work of the ministry. And I want to tell you guys about this because you all are a big part of what's happening in Chicago. You may not know this, but even outside of the Harvest Network, you guys are part of planting churches in the city. We've planted about 30 or so churches in the last 8 years or so in the city of Chicago, and you guys are a big part of that. So I want to say, keep on giving, keep on jumping in and serving and being in the church that you are. And I want to say a big thank you to you all for being the church that you are. Thank you. Thank you for continually giving and being a part of the work of the ministry, not only here, but throughout the nation, and especially in the city of Chicago. Well, y'all, I didn't come by myself this morning. I came with my lovely wife, y'all. She is the sugar in my Kool-Aid. She is the aftershave on my bald head. She is the wonder in my wonder bread, and she is half Belizean, half white, all fine, and she's all mine. And so we got five kids together, and I did not stutter. We have five beautiful babies, four girls, and the last one's a boy. So look, I need y'all to partner with me, and my oldest is sitting right here. I need y'all to partner with me in prayer, okay? Because me and my little man, we're severely outnumbered in the house, okay? And so if you know where I'm going, it's tough out here for a dad of four girls. But I love them, though, and I really enjoy every part of my household with my kids. Now, before we get into the word this morning, I got to give y'all a bit of instructions because y'all are kind of quiet in here. And as you can see, I may look a little different than some of the pastors that grace this stage, and that's okay. I pastor a multi-ethnic church, but y'all can see I'm a brown preacher, right? And so that means as I'm preaching, there may be something that's said that resonates in your spirit, and you're just like, I don't know if I want to say something, but I want to. Say it, okay? Say amen. Say hallelujah. Just don't say bring it home, pastor. That means sit down, okay? So we're going to practice because I need y'all to get this. Say amen on the count of three. One, two, three.
Amen.
All right, say hallelujah on the count of three. One, two, three. Man, y'all got this thing. I love it. I love it. I love it. Well, I'm glad to be here with y'all. See, look, I want you to talk because we're already halfway to a Southern Black church with this heat, all right? And so we're going to sweat it out. We're going to have church this morning up in here. So meet me in Psalm 138. This is a psalm that's near and dear to my heart. I love it. This is one that I always come back to. This is not necessarily a psalm of ascent, but it is a psalm where David writes to us about the steadfast love of God. And I don't know about you all, but throughout the past year or so, or the past couple years of this pandemic, and even in this year leading up to this moment, this summer, I need to be reminded of how much God loves me, how much he cares for me. And for me, it's always good, especially in the summertime, entering back into the fall, to kind of slow down a moment and just think about the goodness of God and just say, thank you. Thank you. And that's exactly what David does. He slows down in this psalm, and he's thanking God for his steadfast love and his faithfulness. So meet me in Psalm 138. That's where we'll be. If you're able, I'm going to ask, and you're not too hot, to stand on your feet with me as we read the Word of God. I'm going to treat you like you're my church. We're going to read the Word of God together. Psalm 138, if you're able to stand with me as we read and honor the Word of God. Starting in verse 1, it says, I give you thanks, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness, for you have exalted above all things your name and your word. On the day I called, you answered me. My strength of soul you increased. All the kings of the earth shall give you thanks, O Lord, for they have heard the words of your mouth, and they shall sing of the ways of the Lord, for great is the glory of the Lord. For though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand delivers me. The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. The very word of God, amen. Today, I want to preach on the topic, God's steadfast love. God's steadfast love. Before you sit down, let me pray for us. Father, thank you so much for your goodness. I do thank you for this word. I do thank you for the sharing of pulpits and being able to be with extended church family today at Harvest. God, I pray that as I speak, you would hide me behind the cross so that you may be lifted up and they hear a word from you. Father, have your way in this place, and we all say in the mighty name of Jesus, amen, amen. You can be seated. Well, Harvest, let me ask you. You ever met or known someone where they've gone through an immense amount of trauma? They've had some hard times in their life. They've experienced some heartache, whether that be circumstances of their own or things around them. And by simply knowing their story, you would think that they would be the type that would walk around and kind of be moping and be a Debbie Downer. But every time you come in contact with them, you're thrown off because they're always smiling. You know someone like that? Someone is always smiling despite their circumstances. Maybe that's you this morning. I remember my grandmother. My grandmother, she was a woman of faith, and even after losing my grandfather and living through Jim Crow South and hospital visit after hospital visit with diabetes, she never stopped smiling. She was always smiling, and she would always look at me, and she would tell me, smile, smile. And in fact, she would say, smile, Big Shooter. Now, y'all can't call me Big Shooter. That was her nickname for me. She said, smile, Big Shooter, smile. And I never understood why she would smile knowing her story. But when I look back and I remember my grandmother, I remember that she didn't miss a week of church. She was always in church. She was the daughter of a Baptist preacher. Watch this. She always smiled because no matter what came her way, no matter the heartache, no matter disease, she smiled because she was rooted and built up in Christ. Hence, the person that was behind her smile or behind her strength was Jesus. And I wonder if there's anybody in here this morning that can resonate with that. You walked in this morning and you're smiling, but it's not because of how you feel or something you've done. Your life might be chaotic right now, but you're smiling because of Jesus. What's the point here? Listen, when believers are facing trials, tribulations, perhaps even giants in your life, we always have to remember that God is with us, that He never leaves us, He'll never give up on us. He is the person behind our smile. Now, for some of us, though, this may be a little bit tough because you walked in here this morning and you don't really know where you are with Jesus. You were smiling yesterday. Today, you're not smiling, and your feelings are wavering like the wind and the waves, and you don't know what to feel today. You're not smiling anymore. You don't know where you are with the Lord, and you walked in, and you're in the right place. You're searching for something, but you don't know whether the smile or the frown. So this may be tough for some of us because you're going through it right now, or maybe you just came out of it. Friends, today in our text, David writes about how thankful he is for the Lord in his life. This psalm begins the ending of David's psalms as we know them from Psalm 138 to 145. And as some of you Bible readers know, David has gone through some mess in his life. He's had some problems, some of them his own, some others, but he's gone through a lot. And the Lord has always been there. And he writes and he says, "When I called, you answered me." God never left him. He never let him go. Today, again, I want to talk about the steadfast love of God. Got 3 points, and I'm out your way, and we get out this heat. Number one, God hears your call. Number two, God regards the lowly. And number three, God preserves you through your troubles. God hears your call, God regards the lowly, and God preserves you through your troubles. Now, as we jump in today, this psalm is an offering of thanks to the Lord. Verses 1 through 3 let us know that David, he gives thanks to the Lord because he says, "On the day I called, you answered me." So let's dive in a bit. Verse 1 says, "I thank God with my whole heart." Everyone say whole heart. He says, "I thank God with my whole heart." Now, notice he does not say a piece of my heart. He says, "My whole heart." David's saying, "You have all of me, Lord. You have all of my heart, not just a little bit, all of me." Now, this is important because I believe we tend to discount our worship when it comes to God. Or what I mean, we don't give God our whole heart of worship. Let me break this down a little bit. Let me step into your neighborhood a little bit. It's easy to come to God when things are good, and we'll say, God, I'll give you this part of me, I'll give you this thing right here, but what really happens is that as we're saying we'll give this up, unconsciously or even consciously, there's a part of us that we're like, God, I'm going to hang on to this one, though. This one right here, this is mine. God, I'll give you part of my finances. But this part over here, God, it's the summertime in Chicago, and it's warm outside, and I got to keep this part for my shoe budget, my Tevas and my Birkenstocks, my Jordans. You got to say all of them because y'all come from different places in here. And so I got to keep this part, God, but I'll give you this part of my finances. I'll give you this part of my relationship, God. But this one over here, you know, this was... This part right here, this is where we get jiggy with it, God. This is mine. This is the bedroom. I got this one, God. And we all do this, don't we? God, I give you this part of my heart, but this one over here, I'm going to hold on to this a little bit. We all do this, even myself. I remember being in college when I'd just given my life to the Lord, and I was, maybe you guys can remember when you first came to know Jesus, I was running hard for the Lord. I said, God, I'm going to give this up. I'm going to do this. And I was just telling everybody about Jesus, not just preaching. I was walking down the street, and I'm telling everybody about the goodness of Jesus. And I remember this was a time that I as I'm giving things up, I'm starting to notice things in my life that I love a little too much. I'm an 80s baby, so I love hip-hop. Anybody like hip-hop in here? I love hip-hop music. I'm a hip-hop baby. And so as I'm coming to know Jesus, I'm like, man, this music is like, I love it. I still love it to this day, but it was kind of, I needed to give it up for a little bit. It was running a little bit too much of my life. And so I had the bright idea. Now, I had all the classics, y'all. I had all the classic CDs. Everybody know what CDs are still? You know, I had all the CDs, and I had hundreds of them, and I said, I'm gonna get rid of these CDs. So I brought out my big booklet of CDs, and I'm flipping through the pages, kind of tearing up as I'm doing it. And I bring out all the CDs one by one, and I cut them up, or I break them in half, and throw them on the ground. My roommate still cries about it to this day. But here's the problem. I got rid of the physical copies. But this was the day and age where, you know, Napster and all the different online music stuff was coming out. So I had already put all the music on my computer. And so I got rid of the physical copies, but the digital copies on the computer, it was way harder to get rid of all of that. You see, I gave God part of my heart, but there was a part of me that I was holding on to. And David says here in the text, I'm thankful with my whole heart. Meaning that his heart's not spread amongst all these other places, but instead it's all with God. His whole heart belongs to God, not with his money, not with his job, not with his spouse, not with his kids, not with his CDs, but with God. And before we move on this morning, I have to ask you, Harvest, does God have your whole heart? And again, that's a difficult question to answer this morning, because some of us, again, we've walked in this morning. We don't know where we are with God. And some of us, frankly, we just answered that question way too quick. Yes, God, you got all of my heart. And the reality is he doesn't have any of your heart. Does he have your whole heart? And see, the reason I ask this is because in this psalm, David seems to be hurting, or he's just gone through a tough time, and he says, I give thanks with my whole heart. That's tough. This is simply easier said than done. Listen, it's easy to say, God, you can have my whole heart when good things are happening, good times are happening. You can have this, you can have that. But do we say, God, you can have all of me when times get hard, when stuff hits the fan, when the air condition goes out? God, you can have all of me. But if we're honest, it's in those times that we tend to forget the goodness of God, and what we do is we turn to something else that's going to give us immediate satisfaction, something else that's going to give us immediate fulfillment. We forget the goodness of God. So let me ask you again, are you thankful to God not only in the good times, but are you thankful when times get hard? Do you give him honor? Do you give him praise when you're hurting? The question, it's pertinent, and I've camped out here a bit because, listen, it's in this place of hurting. It's in this place of pain. It's in this place of brokenness that as believers, really we're to thank him the most. Why? Listen, because most of the time, it's in the midst of brokenness that we see God for who he truly is. It's in the place of brokenness, in the place of helplessness, in this place of pain, that we can either do one of or two things. We can either run towards God, or we can run away from God. And sadly, we tend to do the latter. We run away from God because whether we say it out loud with our mouths or we just believe it in our hearts, we tend to blame God for our pain. And we begin to say things or question God. Why would you do this, God? Why would you allow this to happen to me? Why, God? Why is this going on? Listen, friends. God doesn't allow brokenness. He doesn't allow pain. He doesn't allow all the trials in our lives for us to see him as vindictive or this mean God. But instead, the hope is that in the midst of the trials, in the midst of the brokenness, in the midst of the pain and the helplessness, that we'll turn and learn to rely on God all the more. Sometimes God allows hard things, things that are too big for us, i.e. a pandemic and all the racial tensions that came with it and the political drama and the murder and all the things that have happened throughout the last few years, not to tear us down, but that so we now learn to depend on him all the more. It's like Paul says to the Corinthian church when he's describing the overwhelming trials when he was journeying through Asia. He says in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9, look at this with me. He says, "Indeed, we felt that we received the sentence of death." Paul says it was so hard that we thought that you'd sentence us to death. But then he says that was to make us to rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. Wow. David here writes in this psalm as a man that has been through some hard places. We'll get to a little bit later. And because of God bringing him through it all, he gives him praise with his whole heart. Is that you this morning? God, you have all of me. Or do you tend to turn somewhere else other than God? That's the question. David gives thanks to God with his whole heart. He even says, I give thanks, verse 2, before the gods, which means he doesn't care who sees him, whether by gods he's referring to the present-day rulers of the land or he's referring to the actual angels. He says, I give thanks with my whole heart. I don't care who sees me. And hear me, that's a word for some of us in here. I might step on some toes a bit with this, but hear me, we need to stop thinking about what everybody else is thinking about our worship. We need to give God our whole heart, our unapologetic whole heart of worship. That means praise God in the grocery store the same way you praise him at home. Praise him in church the same way you praise him at home. And I got to say in church, sadly, because I was looking around the room and y'all got some great worship here, vertical worship. Y'all are amazing, all of that. But some of y'all are raising your hands and this and that, and you're in here and you got the spirit of the Lord. But as soon as you open your eyes and you're like, thank you, Jesus. And then you open your eyes, you look around and nobody else has their hands up. You're like, oh, nope. I'm not going to be the one. I'm not looking funny today. And now you just sit there like this doing worship. And the reality is that some of you all have been through some mess in your life. You've gone through some things in your life, and God has brought you through it. And you need to shout with a voice of triumph, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for bringing me through it. You need to shout and give me amens a little bit more because God has been good to you. Whole heart of worship. David, if you keep reading about David, my man David, he worshiped God so much to the point where he didn't care about what anybody actually thought of him. I mean, my man was, the Bible says that he basically danced naked. Now, I'm going to go out on a limb here. I'm not a pastor or elder at this church. And I believe they want you to give your whole heart of worship, but keep your clothes on, okay? Keep your clothes on. I know it's hot in here, but y'all keep your clothes on. Worship the Lord. Worship the Lord. David didn't care. Verse 2, he says, I bow toward your holy temple and I give you thanks for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. God's love, listen, never fails. It does not give up. He sticks and he stays. But let me keep moving, because David then says, for you exalted your name and your word above all else. What David is saying here is, I give thanks because in seeing how vast your glory is and how magnificent you truly are, the same God who hung the stars in the sky. And Psalm 147:4 would tell us that he knows all of them by name. The same God who put the moon in the sky and the sun in place. That same God, he's saying, cares for me. And you didn't have to do anything for me, but you choose to love me and you didn't let go of me. David says, you didn't give up on me. Wow. I wonder how many of us can give praise this morning for the same thing. You've gone through some things in your life. You may have walked in here this morning and you feel like nobody can resonate with your story. Maybe it's this past week or this past year or two, and you've gone through some trial and your friends have turned their back. It feels like nobody's in it with you, but you're sitting here today because God never gave up on you. His steadfast love endured. His faithfulness never ran out. I wonder how many of us can give God praise for the goodness of God in your life. He's a good God. David says, verse 3, on the day I called, and you answered me, and the strength of my soul increased. David says, I was weak. I needed help, and you answered. Now watch this, because I love this part, because he says his soul was strengthened. You notice he doesn't mention anything physical. You see that? He says his soul. Basically, David, being a king, he says, I may not have looked like I needed help on the outside, but my soul was downcast, and you strengthened me in the inner man. How many of you know that sometimes your hurt and your pain resides in a deeper place that people can't really see with their eyes? See what David is referring to is that sometimes the hurts that occur, the trials that occur in our lives, the troubles, the pains that we go through, they're not always physically seen. Meaning, we may look good outwardly, but we're literally dying on the inside. And this is a major problem, especially in America. Over the past few weeks and past few months, honestly, if I can be honest for just a moment, I've literally, as a pastor, someone who loves the Lord, I've been crying out for Jesus on the inside because of all the things that have been happening in our nation, around our country, even in our city, Chicago, our young people being killed at gunpoint, racism, political drama over all of it. I've been hurt, and pretty probably like many of you, if I would venture out to say. But if you look at me on the outside, I look okay, right? I look good. Nice shirt, pretty clean. But on the inside, my soul has been downcast. And I need to be strengthened just like David says here. You see where I'm going with this? Numbers before the pandemic said that 1 in 10 Americans were dealing with depression. Now, one can't really find a counselor if they try to find one. It's heightened. Addictions now are off the charts. And the problem with this is that even with all of this happening, you still can't just look at someone and tell that they're struggling. You know why? Because we have become really good at masking our pain. How many times has someone asked you, I'm gonna just ask in the last week, how are you doing? And you just said, I'm good, I'm fine. You put a smile on, and reality is you're really hurting. But instead of telling them the truth, I'm fine, I'm good, everything's okay. Why can't we just be honest? You know, one of the biggest reasons I think we're not honest, it's not the only one, but one of the reasons I think that we struggle with honesty when someone asks how we're doing is this idea of self-sufficiency. It's this idea of individualism, or some would just say it's flat-out pride. We've been reared, all of us in a country, or raised with this idea of not wanting to give off this need or the perception of being in need. It's like the phrase is keeping up with the Joneses. Y'all heard that before? I'm just keeping up with the Joneses. If you grew up like me, you've heard, I'm just trying to keep up with the Joneses. See, the problem with this phrase is that you ain't the Joneses, you the Smiths. You the Pucketts. Which means that unlike the Joneses, you might need some help. And that's okay. Nobody gets to where they are without help in their life. But see, this idea of self-sufficiency or this individualistic attitude has broken many of us down to the core. And the reality or the truth is that many of us, if not all of us in here, need some help. David says in the passage that God strengthened him in his soul and at his core, which means, watch this, that his core problem was something deeper and much bigger than he could fix by himself. Hence the wording, when I called, you answered me. Here's David, a king. He's literally killed giants, lions, bears, tigers, oh my. And here he is ruling over a nation, and he's calling out for help. But yet, you and I, regular old people, we really struggle in a time of need to ask for help. David's a king, and he's calling out. Family, we struggle many times because in reality, we're just too prideful to acknowledge our need for help. There's some of us, I imagine, in a room this size that need prayer this morning. You've been praying, but you need somebody else to pray over your situation, but the reality is nobody in here knows about it. Not a pastor, not a small group leader, nobody knows you need prayer. Some of us need counseling. We're struggling right now, but you haven't talked to any elders at the church, nobody in the church knows, and you're just struggling by yourself. Some of us are having financial hard times, but yet the benevolence budget, it hasn't moved at all. Nobody knows. Some of you have some pandemic babies, as I like to call them, and you got a lot of kids in your house now, and you need help. You need a babysitter, but all these young people, as I just heard about in the church, and nobody knows you need a babysitter. Can I help you? Listen. Stop letting your pride get in the way of your help. Let me say it over here. Stop letting your pride get in the way of your help. David is a king. Help me. Verse 6, he says that although God is high and lifted up, he regards the lowly, meaning he cares. But then he says, the halt he knows from afar, meaning that although God is high and lifted up, he helps the humble and the people that know they have a need, as opposed to those that run around acting as if they have it all together. Scripture tells us, James 4:6, that God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Listen, we cannot be helped if we don't acknowledge our need and ask for help. Now, notice I didn't say God helps those who help themselves. That is not Bible. I said, acknowledge your need for help. Because the reality is, sometimes that's all you can do. God, help me. Pastor, I need some help. Somebody pray over me. Because you're struggling. All you can do is call out. You don't have the strength to do anything by yourself. Sometimes all you can do is call out. Help me. Here's the king in our text saying, he's calling out for help. And he says, God, you answer me. But I know, some of us, we're still stuck. I get it, but I still don't want to call out for help. Well, look back at verse 2. I love this. David here, he's recognizing that he serves an almighty God. God's greater than him. He praises his word above all else. But yet he says, you love me, and he can take care of me. Now, here's the truth. When we truly understand, and I do mean understand, when we believe we have a God who's almighty on our side, as I said before, the same God who hung the stars in the sky, who created all things, the same God who put the moon and the sun in place, when we understand that this same God is the same God on our side, he loves us and he can take care of us. Not only now do we run to him in times of trouble, but watch this. Now we learn to walk now from a place of freedom in him, because now you're no longer relying upon your own strength to get through the day, but you're relying upon the strength of an almighty God. That's good news. But I know why I got the golf clap, because some of us we still don't see this thing. Let's look a little closer at David. King David, he was indeed a mighty man. Mighty man, but he was not perfect at all. He forced himself and slept with another man's wife. Many theologians would say he raped her, got her pregnant, and then he misuses his power to try and cover up what he did by killing her husband. He then suffers the consequences of his sin. He loses that baby that Bathsheba's pregnant with. Absalom, his son, sleeps with his wives and tries to overthrow his kingdom. Another son sleeps with his daughter. Then Adonijah, another son, tries to overthrow the kingdom once more. And then all three of these guys are brutally murdered with the sword. Y'all, David's been through some mess. And I didn't even mention the 15 or so years he had to run from Saul for his life before he became king. But yet he says in this passage, I give thanks for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. Steadfast, listen, meaning that God's love, despite all of this mess, whether it's David's or something someone else has done to him, God's love was unwavering. That's what steadfast means. It was firm. See, God's love never changed despite David's actions. That's key. God's love was firm when David saw Bathsheba, when she was splish-splash taking a bath, and he should have been out in the field with his army, but yet he sees her and says, come on into my chambers. God's love was firm when he lay with her and got her pregnant. God's love was firm when he figures this out and he calls back her husband, Uriah. Come on back in, Uriah. I need you to go home and be with your wife to try to sleep with her and to cover up his mess. God's love was firm when that didn't work, and he says, well, Uriah, go on out to the front lines, and he puts him at the front lines in order for him to be killed. And see, when that happened, God's love was still firm, because right after that, he says, well, Bathsheba, you can come on into my house, the wife of a man that he just murdered. But hear me, God's love was firm even more so when David came to the realization of what he did, and he said, God, forgive me. Wash me clean. Restore the joy of my salvation. See, God's love never changed with anything David did. It never changed. And someone in here needs to hear that this morning. God still loves you no matter what you've done. He still loves you even to seeing the depth of your heart. He still loves you. Friends, what I'm trying to get across is that God's love is like the song says, it never fails, it never gives up, and it never runs out on us. See, his love covers a multitude of sins, and if he can cover David's sin and all those other people, as we read the Bible through and through, if he can cover all the sins of all those people, then he can cover your sin, he can cover your sin, he can cover your sin, he can cover my sin too. But we first got to acknowledge our need for God. Harvest, have you acknowledged your need for God this morning? Again, maybe it's been a rough week, tough year. Have you just stopped and cried out and said, God, I need you. God, I need you. David, as he gets to the end of the passage, he says, not only did you hear my call, God, not only do you regard the lowly, but you also preserved me through my troubles. He ends this psalm in verse 7 and 8 saying that although I walk through trouble, you preserve my life. You stretch out your hand against my enemies. Your right hand delivers me, and the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Now, let me ask you, you ever been at a place in your life where things just kind of didn't make sense and you just stopped and said, God, what are you doing right now? God, what's going on? Why is this happening? Just feels like everything is changing in life. Nothing is consistent, and you just find yourself saying, God, what's going on? What are you trying to do, God? What are you doing right now? Maybe you're in a place where you're married and your marriage is not where you want it to be. Maybe you're single and you're desiring to be married, or you're just in a place where you're struggling within yourself. Maybe you feel lonely and you don't have friends right now. Maybe financially you're not where you want to be, or you're not in the job that you want to be in. And just find yourself in this space saying, God, what are you doing right now? I'm trying to be faithful, God. What are you doing right now? See how David ends this psalm and this song, if you want to say, praising God for his steadfast love. This is after all the turmoil in his life. And I believe he's writing this to remind himself and the readers, all of us, of how God is still faithful, because despite all this mess, Solomon, his son, still becomes the king and reigns over the nation. But sometimes, family, if we can be honest, it's really hard to give God thanks and give God praise in the midst of the storm, because we're too busy trying to figure out what God is doing. What are you doing right now, God? What's going on? And sometimes, unlike David, we haven't done anything to get into the storm. We've been doing well in our lives. I remember early on in my ministry, my wife and I, we were on staff with Campus Crusade for Christ, and we were raising support as missionaries, and we were really struggling. We were really struggling at the time, trying to raise financial support and asking people to join us in our ministry. And I was working a couple jobs on the side, trying to make sure ends met, and we had our oldest daughter at the time, and we were still struggling. And I just found myself praying this to God all the time. God, what are you doing right now? God, what's going on? I followed you into the ministry. I believe this is what you've called me to do. I'm preaching the gospel. I'm sharing with students. I'm sharing the word. People are coming to know God, but why am I struggling right now? And it was during this time that I was praying this that we had our first miscarriage. God, what are you doing? Struggling financially. And I remember going to the doctor with my wife, and we were sitting there, and we heard the heartbeat. Boom, 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 boom. And it was so much joy that filled our hearts. And then we went back the next week because my mother worked at the office, and she wanted to hear the heartbeat. And they hooked my wife up, ultrasound, and we couldn't hear the heartbeat. All the air left the room. God, what are you doing? What are you doing right now? And it was during this time that it didn't make sense. I started to feel as if God was doing something new in our hearts to change the ministry focus. And I believe that God was saying, God was calling me through some friends and people telling me all around me. And I started praying about it, but specifically to plant a church and to pastor and preach. And I'm like, I don't know who plants churches. I don't know anything about that. And so I started researching this, and I started to find all these programs, and I went to my wife. This is in the midst of all this struggle, and after miscarriage, and so many the women in here, you already know what she said. It was are you crazy? All of this is going on, and you want to change something? It was a hard no. And so I began to pray for 6 months, and I kept praying, God, what are you doing? What do you want to do right now? And after 6 months, we had another miscarriage. What are you doing, God? And what I didn't know is that God was working in my wife's heart as well as mine, this change in our ministry focus. And she came to me and she said, this is what we need to do. And so we moved to Memphis, Tennessee. And what I did not know is that this would be one of the most fruitful seasons of ministry for us. The church community that we entered into, I did my Master's of Divinity for free. Let me say it again, y'all missed it. For free. Planted a church there. And then fast forward, we now have 5 kids. Started another church here in Chicago that's vibrant, where hundreds of people call that place home. I serve on leadership boards across the nation and preach to many people all over the place and lead pastors. And I'm not telling you all this to toot my horn and say, look at what God did with me, but I'm hopefully trying to really encourage somebody where you are right now, because you may be in a space where you feel like God is not being faithful and you don't know what's going on in your life right now. But I come to tell you that God's love never ends. It's always steadfast. His faithfulness runs out. He loves you, and he'll love you to the very end. I'm a testimony to the goodness of God. David says in verse 8, the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. I love that, but for some of us that may have missed that, the Jesus Storybook Bible says it this way. It's what I read with my kids. It says, God loves you with a never-ending, never-giving-up, unstopping, always, and forever love. He's faithful. He's faithful. Turn to your neighbor. Go ahead, black church, and say, he's faithful. He's faithful. But as we end the day, I don't want to end and just believe that everyone in here believes that. You may be in a crazy season like David. You may be in a season like Paul, where you feel like God is literally giving you some type of death sentence and it just feels like it's all over. You may be in a season like my wife and I, where it's just plain old hard. Let me ask you, wherever you are right now, will you choose to believe today in the steadfast love of God? The same love that created man out of the dust of the earth and blew breath into his lungs and we became a human being. The same love that created all of us, no matter what we look like or what our background is, in the image of God. The same love that sent Jesus down here to die the death that we deserved on the cross for you and I, to pay the penalty for our sins, our wrongdoings. The same love that conquered the grave when Jesus gets up and defeats Satan, sin, and death and leaves it there once and for all. And the same love, family, that keeps us even when times are hard, until Jesus comes back to take us home. Will you choose to believe with me in the never ending, the never giving up, unstopping, always and forever love of God? He's a good God. Harvest, listen, don't give up. Don't quit. Keep on believing. In fact, keep on smiling, remembering that God is with you every step of the way. Let's choose together to believe in the steadfast love of God. Amen. 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 Let's pray. Amen, amen. God, we give you praise this morning. We give you thanks for your steadfast love. We give you thanks that in the midst of hard times, you are still good. We give you thanks that even in the midst of us forgetting of the goodness of God and turning our own way, that you still love us. You still yearn for us to come home, your creation to come back to you. So God, I pray for the person that in here that may be whether confused or has never given their life to you, Lord, that even now that you would work in their hearts to bring them to the understanding of who you are, that right now they would confess with their mouth and believe in their heart that you are Lord, that you've saved them. And based on the confession, that they be yours. I pray for the person here that's struggling with their faith, God, that knows you but has had a, whether it be a rocky week or rocky couple years, God, that they make your feet their home, and that you'd be the one that steers the car, drives their life for the rest of their life, that they would come back to you, and as your word says, that you're just and righteous to forgive. God, for all of us, I pray that we'd walk with your love, your steadfast love, at the forefront of our minds in everything we do, everything we say, and the peace of God would rest on our hearts. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus that we all said together, amen and amen. God bless you.